bringing the Beat Generation to Uppsala for 19 years running, I think. Almost. I can still remember in the 90s when Rolf introduced me to Anne, and she came walking up the stairs in the first shop. And in that old shop in the old wooden house, which was upstairs, in a courtyard with no windows, and it's amazing anybody ever found us at all. But Anne found us, and that was the beginning of a beautiful friendship.
Is?
Yeah. And so she's been coming to talk about different aspects of the Beat Generation, the American 60s, and her husband Samuel has been coming to talk about the blues and blue and the history and politics and all sorts of things. And there's been a lot of dancing, a lot of good times, and a lot of poetry. And yeah, it's been fantastic. And so every year, we traditionally finish up our Culture Night program with these amazing spirits, fantastic people. And so again, once again, in a repeat performance, I am so happy to welcome my very good friend, Anne Charteris. Give her a warm hand.
There aren't that many people or that many places where the Beats are still alive. And this really is a very special place because you do honor something that happened a very long time ago. Sam Charteris is here too, my husband, and he will be reading some poetry of Kerouac's a bit later. But I'm here tonight to talk about a book that I didn't write and I didn't edit, but I just wrote the foreword to it. And this is the book about Peter Orlovsky's life. It's not about him, it's by him. Peter died 4 years ago, but he left a lot of manuscripts, and they were assiduously collected by Bill Morgan, who has written, I'm sure you know his work if you are interested in the Beat writers, and he's done a very fine collection of Peter's letters, and journals, and poems, scraps of paper, whatever you can think of. This isn't all of it, but I think it's the best part of it. And I got a call about a year ago while I was in Stockholm from Bill saying, would I write the foreword? And I was very honored to do so because I knew Peter and I love Peter. I do not have an impartial view of Peter's work as a writer because to know him as a person was, well, something that has been one of the landmarks of my life. I met him as I was a student in Berkeley in 1956, and I met him on a blind date. I had no idea who he was, but I had a roommate in the cooperative dormitory where I was living, and she didn't think I was meeting enough people in my classes. So she had been born and brought up in San Francisco, and she was an artist. She was studying art at Berkeley. And she made a few phone calls and arranged for me to go out to a poetry reading and have dinner first. And I was delighted to go on a date, a blind date. Why not? Because I really thought my roommate was a pretty cool chick, although those weren't the words I used then in 1956. Anyway, Peter showed up at the dorm. And he was a very good-looking fellow. He was blonde, and he had a very sharp nose and etched features, and he was beautiful, I thought. And I asked, you know, where his car was, because we were going to go down to have dinner in Berkeley, far from the co-op. And he said, I don't have a car. And I had never dated anyone in California. I was from Los Angeles. I never dated any boy who didn't have a car. So right there, Peter made a big impression on me. He wanted to walk probably 5 kilometers down to the cottage on Milvia where he had cooked the dinner. He said it was spaghetti and it was really good and I'd love it when I got there. So what can I say? We started walking. And by the time I got to the cottage, I was pretty hungry. But I was very surprised to find that at this Milvia cottage, it was full of people. And all the people that had been there, many of them had cars, and they were all having dinner at Peter's spaghetti, drinking a lot of red wine, just before going off to a poetry reading. And I was out of luck. There was no spaghetti. It was all gone. He showed me the pot. It was a huge pot on the stove. And he was very proud of having cooked it. I was proud that he was proud, but I was hungry too. Anyway, he gave me some bitter red wine, cheap red gut wine at that time, and I had a little bit of that, and then it was time to pile into a car. I'm not sure he really did introduce me to Allen Ginsberg, and he certainly didn't tell me that Allen Ginsberg was his lover. That I certainly would have remembered. But we were swept along in the rush to get to the little theater in Berkeley where the reading was going to take place. And I'm sure that the car was driven, because there was a car that took us. Must have been 20 people piled into that car. And the driver probably, I'm sure, was Neil Cassidy. I sat behind him, so I just saw the back of his neck. So I don't have any amusing stories to tell about Neil Cassidy. On the other hand, I do have many stories to tell about Peter, because I really liked him. And he wasn't going to give any of his poetry at the reading. I don't think actually he had started writing poetry. He started the next year. But on the other hand, while the poets set up the stage, they were actually doing a reading that was a repeat of a reading in October 1955, which, if any of you know about the Beats, this was the first time Allen Ginsberg read Howell in San Francisco, and it was an amazing success. The other poets, there were six poets at the Six Gallery, and they had all decided to do the reading again in March of 1956, and that's where I was with Peter. Well, they're all setting up the stage. It was like going to be a minstrel show kind of format. They all had thrones on the stage where they would sit and then give their poetry. And while they set it up, Peter showed me, entertained me. He was a really, he tried to do his best, you know, it was a date. He showed me that the lobby of the theater was filled with an exhibition of drawings. And the drawings were of naked men. Line drawings, exquisite line drawings. Even though I didn't know much about art, I could see they were naked men and that they were very well done. And then Peter showed me a little closer that the men were making love, and some of them were Peter. Okay, some were Alan. It was like I was 19. I was not a virgin, but I really hadn't had a great deal of sexual experience. I'd been raised in a Jewish home, very, very protectively in Los Angeles. And it was the first time I ever knew that, from the drawings, that men did this with each other. And it was like, oh, really interesting. And I looked at Peter, and I was impressed. You know, this was but a little off-putting, too, I must confess. Anyway, we didn't comment much about the drawings. He was very proud to be in them, and I can understand that, because Robert Levine was a very good artist in San Francisco. Peter also didn't tell me that he'd been Levine's lover. And it was Levine who introduced him to Ginsberg, and then Ginsberg fell in love with Peter, and Peter became his partner for the rest of Allen's life. Now, it was a very tempestuous relationship, because Ginsberg was gay, he was a homosexual, Peter was bisexual, and really preferred girls, he told me. But he also was swept by the charisma of Ginsberg, and he consented to be his lifelong partner. But if you read this book, you will find that Peter's doubts, which he expressed in his journals, also letters to Allen, are very clearly expressed, and it was a complicated relationship. Anyway, I love the poetry. I heard Allen Ginsberg read Howell completely through for the first time. He had just finished writing the last section. And I also thought the other poets were remarkable. It was a sold-out house. It was recorded by Fantasy Records. So I can relive the experience by listening to that. And then, of course, I was obviously so straight that there was no chance Peter would want me to come back to the cottage for the party. Why would you bring this straight 19-year-old who just went, oh? So, like the gentleman he was, he walked me back. This is the third time, 5 kilometers. So he had to walk back to the cottage. He did 20 kilometers. He could have done a marathon in Stockholm, you know, with the same, or a half marathon. Anyway, he walked me back, and I remember arguing with him the length of Dwight Way from downtown Berkeley up to the co-op. about one thing that Peter insisted upon. He had never gone to college, but he had very firm literary opinions when it came to Allen Ginsberg's poetry. And he insisted that Allen was as good a poet as Walt Whitman. Now, I was a junior at Cal, an English major. I wouldn't have somebody who had only a high school education lecture me about greatness in poetry. So I disagreed. I violently disagreed. And we had a good time arguing. He tried to date me after that. He sent me letters. They were written on yellow foolscap notepaper, which is the cheapest kind you can have with lines. And he wrote in pencil, and the spelling was atrocious. It was horrible spelling. Again, I could never think of dating a man who spelt so badly. I was stupid. But I was also wary. 19, wary. Peter was only a little bit older than I was. But Alan was 10 years older than I. Jack was even more, 14 years. And these were grown-up men to a 19-year-old without much experience. And I did not want to be part of the scene that Kerouac described and I later read in his novel, The Dharma Bums, the sex scenes at the cottage. I didn't think I would have been comfortable there, and they knew about that, so that never happened. Also, I must confess, since this is candid camera here, that I was in love with him already. So there you are. You know, it was fated to be. But I stayed in touch with Peter. Something about him. Partly it was the fact that we shared a background in that he was Jewish, and I'd been raised to only date Jewish men. See, there was one, you know, a live one. But also his family had come from Russia in the Ukraine, which is where my family, my grandparents had come when they came to America. And I felt very easy with him, very comfortable with him because of his Jewishness and because of his connection to an immigrant past. I really felt that I didn't feel sorry for him. I felt that he was coping with a great many disadvantages, because although I didn't really understand his family background, it really wasn't much like mine. His father had deserted the family. His mother was mentally ill and an alcoholic. He had three or four siblings who were mentally ill. There was never any money. He was raised in Long Island in, near New York City. And he had a terrible childhood, a really abusive one. He dropped out of high school because his mother forced him to go to work to help support the family. And he went into the Korean War, like Sam. Only Sam was sent off to do battle in Alaska, and Peter was a medic in San Francisco. He did never go overseas, but because he had been a soldier in the Korean War, he was given a disability discharge with a check every month, and he basically lived on that check for the rest of his life, and so did Ginsberg lived on that check. Well, I didn't know when I'd see Peter again. My life whirled on. But 10 years later, in 1966, living in New York City and getting, after my doctorate, really involved in the beat writers, my first project was a bibliography of Jack Kerouac's work, because I decided there were really only two interesting writers of my generation. I mean, Charles Cumming hadn't begun writing then, so I didn't have him to consider. But I thought the only two interesting ones were Ginsberg and Kerouac. And while Ginsberg attracted me because he was Jewish, I see that indoctrination was very firm from my parents, I still love Kerouac's novels. And when I had read The Dharma Bums, I felt his description of Berkeley, where I'd been a student for 4 years, was absolutely accurate emotionally. And I wanted to read every word Jack Kerouac wrote after I realized that we were in some way on the same wavelength. So Jack Kerouac was the one, and I decided I would ask Allen Ginsberg for help because I'd heard Jack was drunk and he didn't answer letters. And I wasn't sure I understood his work. So I went to pay a call on Allen Ginsberg, who lived on East 10th Street at that time, 1966. And I remember when he knocked on the door, he didn't know who I was, and I said, I'm Ann Charters, and I am interested in you as a writer, but I think that the more talented writer actually is Jack Kerouac, and I know you know him, so would you tell me how you read him? And he let me in, completely surprised, and that was the beginning of my career, actually. I would never have begun it that way now. You can just imagine. Well, in 1966, Alan and Peter were a couple. They'd been traveling all over Europe and Asia, and Peter was living on East 10th Street. He was doing what he called kitchen yoga or kitchen karma. He was the cook and he was the cleaner. He had two of his brothers living with him at that time, both mentally ill. And I didn't get to talk much with him. He had very long hair. He was very pale. He was very thin. He didn't look at all as charming. 10 years were hard on Peter. He'd obviously been through an awful lot. But I liked him, and I took a picture of him, and he liked the picture, and I was sort of in with him again. In the 1970s, I saw him a lot at Cherry Valley, which was the farm that Allen Ginsberg bought upstate New York to get Peter out of the amphetamine hell, that's Ginsberg's words, in the Lower East Side. Peter was really into amphetamines, and that's one reason, speed, why he looked as bad as he did. Alcohol was bad too. So he got him. Alan bought a farm so that Peter could live there with his brothers and get him a little healthier lifestyle. Didn't speak much to Peter there either because Peter was always rushing around doing chores on the farm. Loved being a farmer. In the 1980s, I saw more of him, actually the most of him, when I was teaching at Naropa, which is the college that Ginsberg and Ann Waldman, the poet, started, and they invited me to come and talk about poetry and about Kerouac. And Peter was there. And one of the years I was there, I think it was 83, Alan got an invitation from Timothy Leary to come to Santa Cruz to celebrate the second annual LSD festival. And Peter was, of course, invited as Alan's partner. And Alan said, I'd love to go, but I'm too busy here in Naropa. Annie, would you go for me with Peter? And I said, absolutely. What a great idea. So that was the most time I spent with Peter. We had a weekend together in Santa Cruz, and he was absolutely marvelous. He was feeling depressed because he had just, with the partner he was with, a woman, had decided to have an abortion. She decided to abort their child. And he had wanted that child, but Ginsberg had told him it wasn't a good idea. And so it had been only a few days before I came, apparently, and Peter was feeling very wretched about that. And he got over it when we came to Santa Cruz a bit, but that was something that I didn't know he would feel so strongly about, and I think it's a terrible thing that he never got to be a father, because he wanted it very badly. At any rate, our whole time with Louis Leary is another story. But continuing with Peter, he came to Stockholm also, and he stayed with us in our house. We then had a house in Storingen. And this time, Peter was really feeling depressed. He hadn't gotten over the abortion problem. He hated Alan, that period of his life. And he refused to stay in the same room with him. Peter took a bedroom downstairs, and he was really terrible to Alan. He made life difficult for everybody. He was traveling with Steve Taylor and Ginsberg. They were doing concerts all over Europe and reading poetry. Ginsberg came to Uppsala that time too, and he gave a wonderful talk at the Humanist Centrum. But Peter wouldn't wear shoes. This was like slushy March weather in Stockholm. The bus drivers wouldn't let him on the bus without shoes. I learned something. You have to wear shoes on the bus. But poor Peter, you know, he was irrational. He was totally out of control. And that was really the beginning of the end with him and his relationship with Ginsberg. He was very violent. He wanted to hurt Alan. I did a reading for the Beat Reader, which is one of the books back here that I did for Penguin, and there was a wonderful evening at St. Mark's Church, but Peter stood against the wall, wouldn't read his poetry, he just absolutely glared at Alan, and we were supposed to be there as a shield between Peter and Alan. It was pretty bad. Finally, the last memory of Peter, actually, I went to see him at Bellevue. He was incinerated there for a while in the hospital, and he had very little to say. He was sedated. and he didn't have anything negative to say about the treatment, although it was a pretty wild hospital in New York City. And then the last was after Alan's death, about 5 years later, 1997. We went to pay our condolences the day before the funeral, and one of the women who was close to Peter said, would we, Sam and me, help Peter buy a suit? He didn't have anything to wear to the funeral the next day. That was respectable. And so we went off to Times Square where there was a tailor, a Jewish tailor, who worked on Sunday, and there was a shop that had suits. And we went up in the elevator, the woman who was part of the Ginsburg entourage, and Peter, Sam and me. And standing next to Peter, he looked at me in front of Sam and said, why don't you and I take a little break from all of this? We can find a hotel close by, spend an hour or two together. And I looked at him. You know, Ginsburg had just died, and Peter obviously wasn't registering the event. And I said, gee, it's a lovely idea, Peter, but not right now. You know, another time. So that perhaps was my one chance to sleep with Peter, but it just wasn't the right time. No? Okay, so that's why I wanted to write about an introduction to this book. If you don't have any idea what Peter looked like, this is him. The cover is a Richard Avedon photograph that was taken, and it was used as a poster and sold in the thousands, millions perhaps, of copies to college kids who would put this on their dorm room, this marvelous naked photograph of Alan and Peter, and when they were very young. And you can see from their bodies, as Peter, who was physically more attractive than Alan, in my eyes at least, he has a very typical body of the time. He didn't work out. I mean, he doesn't have muscles the way, you know, people do who go to the gym now. It was really a different time. So much has changed. And some of what has changed was as a result of the openness of Peter and Alan by posing for this photograph and making it available. That homoerotic love, homosexual love, was illegal at the time. So this was a very daring poster, and I think it was a very useful one for gay liberation. Well, let me read you a little bit about how I wrote about Peter in the foreword. You know, if you have any questions, you should stop and ask me, because I'd be happy to stop and talk about whatever you have on your mind. But also remember that Peter and Alan were often funny. I mean, they didn't take everything so deathly serious. If you've read Beat Literature, you could have met Peter previously on the pages of one of Kerouac's true life novels. Orlovsky made a stellar appearance as the character Simon Darlovsky, a beautiful brother close to Irwin Garden, who was Allen Ginsberg in the book. That was Kerouac's Desolation Angels, published in 1965. This book is a thinly fictionalized chronicle of Jack's adventures with his beat friends during the summer of 1956 and into the fall of 1957. This is when I was at Berkeley, right after I met Peter. As Simon Darlovsky, Kerouac described Orlovsky as one of Jack's favorite mad ones, even before Peter made his first appearance in the book. Raphael Urso, who was Gregory Corso's character, says, quote, what a mad cat. He's insane. And they encourage Peter's madness, unquote. Kerouac emphasized Orlovsky's startling good looks. He wrote, Simon Darlovsky makes me look at him. His intense, wild face with that soft hawk nose and his blonde hair, crew cut now, before a wild shock, and his thick, serious lips like Alan. Kerouac presented Simon Darlovsky as being only 19 or 20 years old. Peter was actually 23 or 24. And he portrayed him as a young, wildly unstable character, completely lacking confidence in his own identity. And that is true. Peter was very shy, and he completely lacked self-confidence coming from that horrible family background. Jack wrote, it gave Orlovsky this to say. He said, Orlovsky. Beautiful brother Jack, listen, here's my hand to you in the world. Take it in shape. Do you know what happened to me the other day? And he cried it out as a perfect reproduction of Allen Ginsberg, and sometimes he imitates Neil Cassidy. Well, I don't remember Peter ever being that manic. He was always Peter, very quiet. But the character might have sounded a little like Orlovsky, but the exaggeration, I say, and the manic presentation are pure vintage Kerouac. He exaggerated. The Peter Orlovsky you'll meet in this book, if you care about the Beats, you might want to give it a glance, has only a slight resemblance to the wacky kid immortalized in Kerouac's sunny pages as the greatest man in San Francisco. He's also probably closer to the silent companion in Ginsberg's tender poetry. Here for the first time, Bill Morgan has used Peter's words to take us behind his handsome, quiet face in the well-known photographs documenting his life with the Beats. Orlovsky's journals, letters, and poems offer us glimpses of his mind, with and without Ginsberg, as Peter's pen often daily captured his thoughts from the mid-1950s to the mid-1980s, when his life began to careen out of control because of heavy drug use. There are at least two different ways to read Peter's story. You could say that following Ginsberg's lead, Orlovsky turned on and became the archetypal hippie or flower power love child of the 1960s. There were obvious differences, of course, between the two men. Orlovsky had a much smaller ego than Ginsberg, and it lacked his poetic genius. Also, unlike Ginsberg, Peter wasn't a natural exhibitionist. He had to get high to take off his clothes in public. He took them off, but he had to be stoned. He was very shy and never felt comfortable, never sought the role of spokesman for the Beat Generation. And as Allen's partner, Peter paid a high price for their permissive lifestyle, because during their life together, he was damaged physically and psychologically by their dedication to drugs and their supposedly open-hearted gay sexuality. Peter had been seriously injured long before he began to live with Ginsberg, suffering from inherited mental illness, receiving inadequate care during his poverty-stricken childhood, drafted into the army at 19 during the Korean War. Orlovsky was discharged as psychologically unfit in 1954. He lived before the introduction of the miracle psychotropic medication that offers help to millions of people today. He survived the chaos of his daily life, saturated with drugs and alcohol on the Lower East Side, and he lived on to die of lung cancer, like so many straight Americans who'd led much less riotous lives. He died in Vermont on May 30th, 2010, shortly before his 77th birthday. A second way to read Peter's story is to regard it as a salutary reminder of the social and cultural distances we've come from the repressive society of Cold War America in the mid-century. During these times, Ginsberg and Orlovsky lived on the edge, experimenting with drugs and sexuality in an effort to open the doors of consciousness and explore the territory ahead. For literary historians, Peter's account of his daily life with Ginsberg, Corso, Kerouac, and William Burroughs is probably the most detailed we will ever have. And that's why I was so happy to see the book. The blurbs of the book, two of them especially, one by Patty Smith, are very interesting. Patty Smith writes, "Peter Orlovsky was the secret heart of the Beats. He wrote and roamed among them. This book contains unknown fragments of their world, the words of their orphaned angel." Well, I'll agree with the unknown fragments of their world. It's a marvelous, intimate back-scenes view of life in the spotlight with Ginsberg. But Peter was not an orphaned angel. About a third of the book are his letters to his mother Kate, and he wrote her all the time. His his checks from the Veterans Administration every month went to Kate, and Kate would forward them to wherever he was living, so he would endlessly write his mother about the checks which he needed to live on. But he also wrote his mother about other things, including me. And one of the things that made the book so dear to my heart was that it includes a letter that he wrote to his mother shortly after our date, 3 days later. And I had never read it before, but here's what he wrote his mom about me. March 21, 1956, letter from Peter Orlovsky in San Francisco to Kate Orlovsky in Long Island. Dear Kate, hello there, old mama heart. Here's a note of sweetness. In the kitchen now, pork chops with seasoning about to be cooked. Beets beating away, going to make them creamy. Adding sugar makes them sweet. I just made a chocolate cake. Fudge icing on top of it. It's to get Lafcadio prepared for his birthday. I mean, Peter was endlessly taking care of his brother, Lafcadio, as well as the other members of his family, including Kate, endlessly sending Kate money, his mother. But his sweetness with the beets is part of his own sweetness. And then he continues, I've been feeling extremely good, so good that living doesn't seem like a big negative problem as it did before. And this is when he's still ambivalent about being the partner for Allen Ginsberg. They're not living together in that cottage on Milvia. Allen's there alone, finishing Howl and writing his short poems about Berkeley, the moral of the short poems. Peter's living in a housing project in San Francisco, taking care of his brothers. So it's the big negative problem living seemed to him before our blind date. There's a big, blue-eyed, mystical-looking 19-year-old girl here who likes me, and I her. So the world's a little bit like heaven now. Oh, my God. I thought I'm past surprises. I mean, good surprises, but this one was a terrific surprise. There's a big, I don't remember I was that big. I weighed, well, very little, but at the time he saw me as big, I guess, or the big blue-eyed, mystical-looking, I was certainly not mystical-looking, but whatever, 19-year-old girl who likes me and I her, so the world's a bit like heaven now. Now I have to add water to the beets, he breaks into that. She goes to California University, English major, studying Thomas Hardy right now. He remembered that when we were arguing about Whitman, I said that Thomas Hardy was the best writer in English and nobody could ever, et cetera, et cetera. I loved Thomas Hardy's poetry, which was not exactly like Ginsberg, as you may recall. Yes. At any rate, I don't think of him as an orphan angel. But the other blurb by the poet Anne Waldman is wonderful. She knew Peter very, very well. And she starts the blurb, can anyone talk to me, hold me as I am? Which means that Peter was never lucky enough to find somebody who really returned his love. And he felt himself not orphaned, but existentially alone, I think, despite his partnership with Allen, who took very good care of him. Anne Waldman continues, this book, Peter's book, is a poignant, intimate, and captivating document of the inner life of Peter Orlovsky, long, lifelong mainstay. She doesn't say partner. She says lifelong mainstay to Allen Ginsberg. Allen loved Peter. Peter did not love Allen quite the same way. So Peter was a lifelong mainstay to Allen Ginsberg and crucial to the Beat annals. Quote, sad, noble Peter, truly an angel, and not my joke boy, end of quote. Allen wrote about him in 1955. Peter was keenly present, albeit a shy participant, in one of the most exciting periods in radical, belletristic, cultural, and political time. I knew him as poet, singer, fellow Buddhist, Naropa teacher, and friend. I can still hear his yodel as he rode his tractor. May he have his say here, out of the shadows and into our hearts. And that's Anne Waldman, and it's a very gracious tribute to Peter, I think. Well, sometimes new books can lead you back to old books. And one of the books that this led me back to for tonight was this marvelous anthology, which was done in 1960 by Don Allen, and it introduced beat poetry to a lot of members. It was published by Grove Press, which was a very radical. They did Naked Lunch, for example, and many Kerouac books. Don Allen worked for Grove Press, and it was natural for him to put this book together. And in the book, he defined poetry that was not academic poetry, which people really didn't write seriously about. But the Beats were part of a whole new generation of poets that really brought new life to American literature. And he puts them, Don Allen, in very strange groupings, but he does include Kerouac, Ginsberg, Corso, and Orlovsky, four writers, as the Beats. He doesn't include any others. This is Don Allen, who was a very smart guy and knew what was happening, and he really saw the San Francisco writers as part of something else. So this has Peter's first published poem, and that's what I want to read out of that. It also has the poem that Allen wrote to Peter when they were first together, and it has some poems of Kerouac's, which Sam is going to read. So I'm going to break into this in a little poetry reading, because you've got to read Peter's first poem. It's funny. Again, don't be afraid to laugh, because he wrote it in Paris, and it's not his first poem, it's his second poem. You can find the first poem on the net. You can find everything on the net. But I like the second. I could have read it, but I decided the second poem is really better. Don Allen thought so, too. Remember to laugh, okay? Morning again. Nothing has to be done, maybe buy a piano or make fudge. At least clean the room up, for sure, like my father. I've done flick the ashes and butts over the bedside on the floor. But first of all, wipe my glasses and drink the water to clean the smelly mouth. A knock on the door, a cat walks in, behind her the zoo baby elephant demands pancakes. I can't stand hallucinations anymore. Time for another cigarette. Then let the curtains rise. And I notice the dirt makes a road path to the garbage can. No icebox, so a dried up grapefruit. Is there any one saintly thing I can do to my room? Paint it pink, maybe? Or install an elevator from the floor to the bed? Or maybe take a bath in the bed? What's the use of living if I can't make paradise in my own room? For this drop of time upon my eyes, like the endurance of a red star on a cigarette, makes me feel life splits faster than scissors. That's good for the second poem. That's damn good. I know if I could shave myself, the bugs around my face would disappear forever. The holes in my shoes are only temporary. I understand that. My rug is dirty, but whose that isn't? There comes a time in life when everybody must take a piss in the sink. Here, let me paint the window black for a minute. Throw a plate and break it out of naughtiness, or maybe just innocently, accidentally drop it while walking around the table. Before the mirror, I look like Sahara Desert ghost. On the bed, I resemble a crying mummy hollering for air. But on the table, I feel like Napoleon. Now for the main task of the day. Wash my underwear. 2 months of use. What would the ants say about that? But how can I wash my clothes? Why, I'd be a woman if I did that. No, I'd rather polish my sneakers than that. And as for the floor, it's more creative to paint it than clean it up. As for the dishes, I can do that, for I'm thinking of getting a job and a luncheonette. My life and my room are like two huge bugs following me around the globe. Thank God I have an innocent eye for nature. I was born to remember a song about love. On a hill, a butterfly makes a cup that I drink from, walking over a bridge of flowers. That's Peter's second. Well, couple of Ginsbergs written about this time. The first one to Kerouac, about falling in love with Peter. I'm happy, Kerouac. Your madman Allen's finally made it. Discovered a new young cat. In my imagination of eternity's boy walks on the streets of San Francisco. Handsome. And meets me in cafeterias and loves me. Don't think I'm sickening. You're angry at me. For all my lovers? It's hard to eat shit without having visions. And when they have eyes for me, it's heaven. I think that says a lot about the relationship and how needy Ginsberg was. He had been in love with Neil Cassidy and been rebuffed just before he met Peter. And he had decided that he was going to be gay. He'd been living with a woman in San Francisco and it just didn't work out. He'd seen a psychiatrist, the well-known story of Ginsberg and Orlovsky. And then to discover that he thought Peter had eyes for him. Notice didn't love him, but had eyes for me and loves me. Yes, it's there. And Kerouac was incredibly anti-gay. Kerouac had a phobia about Ginsberg's being homosexual. And he, when he got drunk, would often be very belligerent about it. So that's why Allen says, "You're angry at me." He knows that he can't really share this with anybody and have Kerouac come back at him and not be happy about this. But it's really hard to be gay and to come out, as Allen did, took a great deal of courage. And when they have eyes for me, it's heaven. Of course, after reading Peter's letter about heaven, you know, heaven, I thought, oh my God, the poem's just about the same time. And I'm sure Peter saw this poem. Then there's another poem that Allen was writing in Berkeley when he was living apart from Peter in San Francisco and thinking about him a lot in the early years of their relationship, the first years. It's called Sunflower Sutra. And I think it's really about Peter. I mean, it's about a sunflower. There they are. You forgot what they look like. But when I read it now after reading Peter's book and knowing Peter's lack of confidence, I think that possibly he had this on his mind, Ginsberg, because Peter was so unlike him. And this is a poem about courage. Courage was really on Allen's mind a lot in those years, as you know from the ending of Supermarket in California. When he meets Walt Whitman in the supermarket, he calls Whitman a courage teacher. And here's another one about courage in the guise of a sunflower. This is a poem that he wrote after Kerouac. He sent this letter to Kerouac in a poem, and then Kerouac came to California, and they took a walk together when Kerouac was staying at the Berkeley Cottage. And the result was this poem, Sunflower Sutra. I walked on the banks of the Tin Can Banana Dock and sat down under the huge shade of a Southern Pacific locomotive to look at the sunset over the Boxhouse Hills and cry. Jack Kerouac sat beside me on a busted, rusty iron pole. Companion, we thought the same thoughts of the soul, bleak and blue and sad-eyed, surrounded by the gnarled steel roots of trees of machinery. The oily water on the river mirrored by the red sky, sun sank on the top of final Frisco peaks. No fish in that stream, no hermit in those mounts, just ourselves, roomy-eyed and hungover, like old bums on the riverbank, tired and wily. Look at the sunflower, he said. There was a dead gray shadow against the sky, big as a man, sitting dry on top of a pile of ancient sawdust. I rushed up, enchanted. It was my first sunflower. Memories of Blake, my visions, Harlem, and Hells of the Eastern Rivers, the bridges clanking, Joe's greasy sandwiches, dead baby carriages, black treadless tires forgotten and unretreaded, the poem of the riverbank, condoms and pots, steel knives, nothing stainless, only the dank monk muck and the razor-sharp artifacts passing into the past. And the gray sunflower, poised against the sunset, crackly, bleak, and dusty, with the smut and smog and smoke of olden locomotives in its eye. Corolla of bleary spikes pushed down and broken like a battered crown. The seeds fallen out of its face, soon to be toothless mouth of sunny air. Sun rays obliterated on its hairy head like a dried wire spider web. Its leaves stuck out like arms out of the stem. Gestures from the sawdust root. Broke pieces of plaster fallen out of the black twigs. A dead fly in its ear. Unholy, battered old thing you were, my sunflower, oh my soul. I loved you then. The grime was no man's grime but death and human locomotives. All that dress of dust, the veil of darkened railroad skin, the smog of cheek, the eyelid of black misery, the sooty hand of phallus or protuberance of artificial, worse than dirt, industrial, modern, all civilization spotting your crazy golden crown, entangled in your mummy roots. And you, there, standing before me in the sunset, all your glory in your form. A perfect beauty of a sunflower. A perfect, excellent, lovely sunflower existence. A sweet, natural eye to the new, hip moon. Woke up alive and excited, grasping in the sunset shadow, sunrise, golden monthly breeze. How many flies buzzed around you, innocent of your grime? While you cursed the heavens of the railroad and your flower soul. Poor dead flower, when did you forget you were a flower? When did you look at your skin and decide you were an impotent, dirty old locomotive, or even the ghost of a locomotive, the specter and shade of a once powerful, mad American locomotive? You were never no locomotive, sunflower. You were a sunflower. And you, locomotive, you are a locomotive. Forget me not. So I grabbed up the skeleton, thick sunflower, and I stuck it at my side like a scepter and delivered my sermon to my soul and Jack's soul too, and anyone who will listen. We're not our skin of grime. We're not our dread, bleak, dusty, imageless locomotive. We're all beautiful golden sunflowers inside. We're blessed by our own seed and golden, hairy, naked accomplishment bodies growing into mad, black, formal sunflowers in the sunset, spied on by our eyes under the shadow of the mad locomotive riverbank. Sunset Frisco, hilly tin can evening, sit down vision. That's the sunflower. I think he wrote it as a religious poem after talking to Kerouac about Buddhism, because in Mexico City, where Kerouac had been living before this time, Kerouac was writing a poem called Mexico City Blues, and he had really discovered Buddhism during his months in Mexico. Sam's going to read you two poems from Mexico City Blues by Jack Kerouac.
I'm so done. You can hear me all right?
I hear you.
Okay, good. There was one thing about Peter. Out of all the people I've known in my life, Peter was the only one who called me Sammy. Hi, Sammy. I've never forgotten his voice. Mexico City Blues was Jack's first attempt at spontaneous writing of poetry. He regarded these as choruses, like a tenor saxophone player improvising in the afternoons, kind of stoned and just drifting along with his thoughts, letting his thoughts come. So he took a page for each one of what he called his choruses in his notebook, and simply the page was the length of the poem, whatever he came up with. And it was published as his first book of poetry. And here are two of them that I think this really was what inspired Ginsberg to be blow free. that when Jack said in these poems where there were no limits, that you go anywhere, you let your mind take you and make the poem that way. Alan was still thinking in literary terms, whereas Jack turned him into a person who could say, I will simply express what I want myself. So here's number, the 211th chorus, one that's read a lot. The wheel of the quivering meat conception turns in the void expelling human beings, pigs, turtles, frogs, insects, nits, mice, lice, lizards, rats, roan racing horses, poxybucolic pig ticks, horrible unnamable lice of vultures, murderous attacking dog armies of Africa, rhinos roaming in the jungle, vast boars and a huge gigantic bull elephant, rams, eagles, condors, pone-pones and porcupines and pills and all the endless conceptions of living being gnashing everywhere in consciousness throughout the 10 dimensions of space, occupying all the quarters in and out to the from my super microscopic no bug to huge galaxy light year bowl, illuminating the sky of one mind. Poor. I wish I was free of that slaving meat wheel and safe in heaven dead. Here's the 225th chorus. The void, which Kerouac returned to again and again and again, the emptiness that he felt was at the bottom of life. The void that's highly embraceable during sleep has no location, no feet. Yet I keep restless, mental searching and geographical meandering to find the holy inside milk Damema gave to all. Damema, mother of Buddhas, mother of milk. Buddhism has entered Kerouac. In the dark, I wryly remonstrate with my sillier self for feigning to believe in the reality of anything, especially the so-called reality of giving the discipline, the Buddhist discipline, the full desert hut workout and Superman solitude and continual enlightened trance with no cares in the open and no walls closing in, the bright internal heaven, the bright internal heaven of the starry night, of the cloud-mopped afternoon mopped. Oh, gold, honey, I've lost my way.
Follow that with Peter's last poem. Peter should have the last word. And the last poem of his is in this book. He wrote it in Vermont, where he had gone to live after Ginsberg had died. Last poem. Feet dance for money, feet dance for life, feet dance for blues. Dear Peter, kiss these feet goodbye. Like a fool, Uncle Pete shot too much coke, and now no money left, not to mention no brains left, and now eat shit for the rest of my short life. Can't even stop smoking. Ain't it a joke? No lungs left, oxygen bottle. How stupid can one get? Is this a royal doha or an anthill? Or dullness from shooting coke? Go to hell, coke. Eat shit, coke. Cigarette smoking has led to everything else bad, and now I can't even stand up straight. My back aches, tooth aches, too much coffee, no sleep. Who wants sleep anyway? Just like an elephant, sleeping standing up, that's the trick. Only want one trick in life, to sleep standing up. That's what an American monk does. Don't ever take coke. Pure poison. A downer. A drag. Pure waste of time. Last words. Thank you. It's really one of the few places on the planet where I could read that poem. This is a very special place. Do you have any questions?
Thanks for doing it. Yes, does anyone have any questions for me?
About Peter's courage, or about Alan and Peter's courage?
No. Why did Peter stay with Adam all that time?
Well, he in his way loved him, and he knew Alan loved him. They were a partnership. You know, why did he stay? Alan took care of him. Alan took care of what went along with Peter, the baggage of his brothers. They would split often. I mean, they traveled uneasily together, and the book is full of how they just couldn't stand it anymore. And Alan went one way and Peter went another. And without Alan, Peter could cope, but just barely. Alan really was necessary, I think. And he offered nothing. I mean, no one would take him in. He doesn't want to go back to his mother. And Alan always had a place, and Peter's check was always welcome. So it was mutual dependency. And it wasn't, I mean, it was good for Alan in a sense, except Peter got to be quite a heavy burden and during the later years. And it just, Peter never cleaned up his act, let's put it that way. And then his psychological problems just overwhelmed him, clearly, at the end. And he wasn't rational. He really went someplace. His mind was destroyed, let's put it that way. I mean, if he could offer me a little date in a hotel room on Times Square. it was interesting being with him, because I understood that with him, all of the social conventions were totally ignored. I mean, you'd proposition a woman in front of her husband on the day before your lifetime partner's funeral. I mean, what kind of a guy would do that? A crazy one. And there was no menace in Peter for me. He did get violent with Alan sometimes. But he never, I've never seen him in public lose control, but then I never saw him when he was really in a bad state. And so I never was afraid of him. But on the other hand, I didn't know what was going to come out of his mouth. And with Gregory Corso, it was the same way, except Gregory was mean. And Peter had not a bone of meanness in him. Gregory would say insulting things and hurtful things, you know. And he had just a big mouth. And that was, so you avoided it, Gregory. And Alan was always lucid. Alan never lost it.
So Peter's gone, and then Carolyn died.
Carolyn Cassidy just passed away, yes.
Who is left?
Well, your bookstore nemesis, Lawrence Ferlinghetti, who started the City Lights bookstore as the first paperback shop, you know, in the United States. McClure is left. Gary Snyder is left. In New York, there's the women. There's Joyce Johnson and Hetty Jones are left. And David Amram would include himself. And Patty Smith has joined the August Company, too. So there are some representatives of that literary event, I think. But the heavies are in San Francisco. Ferlinghetti is just a tribute, and McClure too, of living clean. You know, I mean, they drank a lot of wine, and McClure took a lot of stuff, as we know from his writing. But Ferlinghetti tried to teach Kerouac to avoid the harmful things, but Kerouac wouldn't listen. That's in Big Sur. But Ferlinghetti had many physical problems and always exercised, ate, you know, all the pills his doctor gave him, and he's still here. Not probably for much longer, but he still writes and publishes and doesn't run his bookstore.
Gary, too.
Hmm?
Gary, too.
Gary's too. Yeah, well, Gary's obviously a clean liver, you know, and he's incredibly in good shape. Gary, he's also, I mean, things like cancer, you don't know. That takes people and they kind of lived, you know, healthy lives. But they've also been lucky, these the people who have survived. And Diane de Prima, another fine writer. She's still alive, and not too well, but she's still in San Francisco. And I think she still teaches occasionally at the New School. So there are a lot alive. A few.
Thank you for coming again and blessing
You're
us
welcome.
With your presence. We have two copies of the book on Peter Orlovsky, and I was checking, and there's nothing in print by Peter Orlovsky except for this. So it's a book worth having, and I'm sure Anne would sign
absolutely.
It for 60 euro forward if anyone's interested.
Yep.
And we also have Sam's and Anne's a selection of their other work behind Anne. So take the opportunity to talk to them and get something signed. And thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Further into the
this
culture
great
night.
Culture night. It's amazing today.
Amazing, yeah.
Truly amazing.
Proud. Just remember not to go too gently into that.
I don't think it's possible, especially farther that way.
Yeah,
no, and it gets very noisy down there.
So thanks again, everyone.